Let's pray together. Lord God, please bless the children as they go off to children's church. Please teach them about yourself. Lord God, you know what each person needs right here, right now. We ask that you would speak through this message for your glory. Amen. Before I start, I want to thank many of you that have been praying for me and my family. You've been a great encouragement to us during our time of need. My daughter, Grace, 2 years old, still has an undiagnosed brain disease, but she has increased her vocabulary and seems to be improving. Thank you for praying. Also, thanks to many of in the missions department and the ministers that have helped me with the sermon. I've benefited from many others who have more experience than me. Fasting, just the word fasting, it brings many thoughts to mind, and most of them are not happy thoughts. Is fasting a medieval thing? Do Christians really fast today in this Facebook world? If they do, is it helpful? How can we know what God thinks about fasting? Let's look at his word. Did you know that in his word there are 70 scriptures from our Bible that talk about fasting? We cannot look at them all, but I hope by looking over a few of them, we can see that fasting is a powerful tool used by God, so use it well. That is the main idea of my message today. Fasting is a powerful tool used by God. Use it well. Let's look at the passage in Matthew 6. Jesus' main idea, when you fast, don't brag about it. In these sections, his main idea is don't brag about praying, about giving to the poor, and don't brag about fasting. But that is not likely our problem. I don't see people at Park Street Church taking pictures, oh, here's how I look after a fast, and posting it up on Facebook. It likely is not your big problem. Since this is not a problem, what can we still learn from this passage about fasting? Jesus here assumes that his disciples will fast when he says, when you fast. It doesn't say if you fast, it says when you fast. Jesus assumed his disciples will fast. Why did he assume this? Because in the Old Testament, people who were faithful fasted. In Jesus' time, people who were faithful fasted. Fasting is a way of worshiping God by going without food for a time. Fasting is like praying, but with your whole body. Also, this teaching about fasting was not for the disciples at that very time. Fasting is to bring you close to Jesus, but they were with Jesus. So he told them, don't fast right now. I'm here. But when I'm gone, that is the time to fast. So now is the time to fast. But most people don't fast today, at least not around here. It seems medieval. How is it good news? I know I have a lot to do today to convince you that fasting is a good thing. Let's look at the Bible and see how God uses fasting in three ways. One, to grow us by focusing on him. Two, to guide us with big decisions. Three, to hear us in an emergency. Because I am convinced fasting is a powerful tool used by God, so use it well. God uses fasting so we focus on him. In this passage in the Sermon on the Mount, the question about fasting is, what is its purpose? Is it to impress people or to impress God? When you fast, do it for God, an audience of one, so that God will bless you. We don't do it for people's praise. We do it for God. The center of our faith is Jesus and his death on the cross. Fasting is a small way we get to die to ourselves. Then we eat again, and it's a picture of heaven and the coming feasting and banquet that will happen in heaven. So we thank God when we fast, and we thank God when we eat. Anna was a widow. She was 84 years old. She never left the temple, but worshiped night and day, fasting and praying. She was one of the first to see Jesus. I think God used her because she was so committed to him to even fast and worship all those years. Do you feel like you don't hear from God? Do you have no spiritual eyes or ears? Maybe God is calling you to fast. God can use this to wake you up, to see what he is doing around you. One former missionary of Park Street wrote me, "Honestly, the only time in my life I practiced fasting was while living in New York City, and it was honestly super helpful during that season. It was a way of stepping out of all the excess and overindulgence, of which I was often a full participant for a few days, and reorienting my life on God. I found it easy to lose his voice and perspective in all the noise, career, money, food, entertainment, and striving. Somehow abstaining from amazingly delicious food of New York City for 2 days and living on water and hot tea with a lemon really helped me regain an accurate view, perspective on my life. It helped me hear God. I had a friend who fasted with me, which was really helpful for accountability. She went on to seminary. She served the Lord in the Dominican Republic and then Rwanda, sent by Park Street Church. God grabbed her heart when she fasted for 2 days. Christians in other countries fast a lot. Last week, I read in Christianity Today that Rwanda has outlawed fasting. Too many people were fasting there. 8,000 churches were closed in Rwanda for fasting. What a world we live in. David in the Psalms says, "For zeal of your house consumes me, and the insults of those who insult you fall on me. When I weep and fast, I must endure scorn." David fasted and mourned for God. He was insulted by others, but he clung to God. In Joel, we read, "Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. Blow the trumpet of Zion, declare a holy fast, call a sacred assembly." We fast to draw close to God. We do it in weeping. We are not all powerful. We need God as we need food. We want to know him more, so we try fasting to draw close to God. A different Park Street missionary wrote me, "God is not trying to hide his presence from the world, just that the world gave up looking. We have been blinded with distractions from the enemy. The main point is his faithfulness. Fasting to me means I am serious and sold out, and he is my only answer." This missionary served God in a very dangerous place. Fasting helped her notice God's work and that he was doing amazing things around her. May we see you, Lord God, and hear you through your word and fasting. I think sometimes the reason yoga, which is Buddhist at its core, and other New Age practices are popular even among Christians is we are not committed to a biblical spirituality, which includes fasting. Did you know the early church fasted frequently? They fasted like the prophets of the Old Testament, Moses and David fasted. The early church fasted on Wednesdays and Fridays each week. Luther fasted weekly. Calvin, people say, fasted continuously. Jonathan Edwards and ministers here in New England at that time fasted weekly for revival. Before Jonathan Edwards preached his most famous sermon, he fasted. John Wesley fasted 2 times a week for revival, and required Methodist ministers to do the same. God used fasting for his people to start the Great Awakening in this year, in this area. Will we fast? Orthodox and Catholic Christians also fast. As John Paul II wrote, Jesus himself has shown us by his own example that prayer and fasting are the first and most effective weapons against the forces of evil. Bill Bright, who founded Campus Crusade for Christ, fasted 40 days straight, 7 times. Here's what he has to say about fasting. Combining fasting and prayer can result in a spiritual atomic bomb that pulls down spiritual strongholds and releases the power of God in your life and the life of your church, its pastor, its leaders, and its members. Saint Augustine, from 1500 years ago, said, "Fasting cleanses the soul, raises the mind, subjects one flesh to the spirit, renders the heart contrite, humble, quenches the fire of lust, and kindles the true light of chastity." Billy Graham said, "Believers who never practice fasting and prayer are missing a spiritual discipline that has blessed many throughout the ages. It's hard to fast and pray when we have all these distractions and food advertisements all around us." I get it. How else can God use fasting? God uses our fasting to guide us with big decisions. Jesus fasted 40 days before he started his ministry. Why was this the first thing he did? Satan tempted him, but the key is he was fasting before he went on to preach. The very next thing he did after he fasted was preaching. But it started first with fasting. This is a great reminder. If you want Holy Spirit power in your next big endeavor, fast. Ask God to guide you. Sometimes in grad ministry, I meet a man who's going to propose to a woman. I often ask him to fast about it. You need God's clarity and conviction in those big decisions. Moses didn't eat or drink for 40 days when he was given the law. It was part of God's work in Moses. This is a supernatural fast. Normally, if you don't drink water for a long time, you will die. I do not recommend this, unless God's guiding you. How about fasting with the apostles? In Acts 12, it says, "While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, 'Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work for which I have called them.'" So before the first missionaries were sent out, they fasted. God used fasting to do amazing things. We sent out missionaries just a few weeks ago from Park Street Church. Did anyone fast? They're going to a very difficult place. Every missionary we send out from Park Street goes to a very difficult place. Will we not fast and join with them through that? I hope fasting is part of the missions conference this year. Park Street has done fasting in the past with great results. In 1944, Park Street fasted 1 meal a week and gave the money to help rebuild the churches in Europe. Other churches got involved. This gift was equal to $8 million today. It started World Relief, a ministry which helps churches in developing countries minister to the hurting world. God used fasting as part of Park Street to start this movement. How about during church leadership decisions? In Acts, we read Paul and Barnabas appointed elders for them in each church, and with prayer and fasting, committed them to the Lord in whom they had put their trust. Park Street is in a huge transition, and there has been a massive search for a new senior pastor. The search committee has been working hard for over a year. Will we join them in this search by fasting? I can't think of a more important thing to fast about than a new pastor, one that God has appointed for this church. What else can God use for us to fast about? God uses our fasting to hear us in an emergency. In the book of Esther, where there was a great threat by the king would kill all the Jews, how did they respond? In Esther we read, in every province to which the edict and the order of the king came, there was great mourning among the Jews, with fasting, weeping, and wailing. Many lay in sackcloth and ashes. When emergency hits, fasting is a powerful biblical response. As we read earlier, David, after his sin against Bathsheba and his cover-up murder of Uriah, David fasted. He answered, "While the child was still alive, I fasted and wept. I thought, who knows? The Lord may be gracious to me and let the child live. But now he is dead. Why should I go on fasting? Can I bring him back again? I will go to him, but he will not return to me." Note here that David fasted in an emergency so God would listen to him. Fasting is not always going to work in the way we want it to. But after the baby died, David responded well. We read, "He went into the house of the Lord and worshiped. Then he went to his own house, and at the request, they served him food and he ate." So on the outside, you would think that David's fasting was a waste. But David could worship God after all of this. Later, God would describe David as a man after God's own heart. Instead of being bitter, David had a soft heart for God. This may be the fruit of his prayers and his fasting. As many of you know, this has been the hardest year of my life. A year ago right now, my daughter started walking in a very funny manner. We didn't know what to do. We had the doctors do a scan of her brain. They told us she had 90% chance of a brain disease that would kill her. I was desperate. We were desperate. So what did I do? I tried fasting. Others started talking about grace on the Facebook. So we decided to go public. And here's what we wrote. "Gracie is dying. Please fast and pray for a miracle. Would you pray and fast for Gracie? Reply yes if you will skip a meal or a day and pray for my sweet girl. Jesus can heal her. Ask him to do it on our behalf. The next 8 days are crucial to confirming or hopefully not confirming that she will die in a few years from a brain disease. We have a big doctor's appointment tomorrow at 12. Will you pray and fast for her? Please share. Thank you." Hundreds prayed and fasted. Nano prayers on a cell phone or at your computer is not what I was looking for that day. It would have been an insult to my daughter or to the Lord to ask for such little prayers. We needed deep seeking prayers, petitions with the hope of changing God's heart and mind. The idea that God listens to such a request is hard to imagine. But with David's fast for his baby as my guide, that was what we went for. The idea of asking others is a bit strange, but it seemed like a worthwhile effort. So I thought we should go all in. God worked. When they checked her brain, they didn't find the deadly brain disease that they had thought. It was such a relief. I thank God for all those who prayed and fasted and joined with our pain. A year later, we still don't know what brain disease Gracie has. We don't know the end of the story for Gracie. I hope you never have an emergency like this. But we live in a fallen world. Sin is real. Fallen and cursed world we live in hits us all. But what will you do when the emergency hits? Fasting is a powerful tool used by God. Use it well. Fasting may not be for everybody. Maybe you're pregnant or nursing. taking medication, or have food issues. This may not be for you. Abstaining from Facebook or cell phones for the day might help you pray and draw close to God. A few months ago, Pastor Phil suggested not listening to radio in the car while we were driving. This hurt. I love listening to sports radio. So I understand doing different things is actually difficult. But maybe during your commute, you could dedicate to prayer. But if you are able, I suggest a modest fast. Park Street did one meal a week. It had a huge effect in starting World Relief. Maybe start with that. One meal a week. It's 1/21st of your meals for this week. God might use it to draw you closer to Him and help you pray to Him. If you already fast, great, keep going. Hopefully, now there'll be more people at church on this journey with Jesus. Looking for what to pray for during your fast? The three suggestions I have, and you may want to write them down, are one, to grow closer to God. Maybe to get rid of a sin or an addiction in your life. Two, for our pastor search, or for our missionaries in dangerous places. This week, I encourage you to pray for those going to Revere Beach in this awesome outreach they're doing. Three, any desperate need you know of. If you need one, then pray for my daughter, Grace. You can take the time you would have eaten breakfast or lunch or dinner, and you can go for a fasting prayer walk. Because fasting is a powerful tool used by God. Use it well. Let's pray. God, I thank you that you are the God of love. Jesus, you loved us so much that you died for us. You told us we would fast when you are gone. I pray for those here who will use fasting to focus on you, that you would bless them. Help us all get to know you better. I pray you would bring the right senior minister to Park Street Church. Lord, please protect and bless our missionaries. I thank you for helping my daughter Grace so much this year. In your name, amen.